All right, so what I thought I'd do here, since I was going for my old crap, and I noticed that, well, I did this for the GameCube and the Genesis Mega Drive before, and they're pretty much in date, nothing's changed with those. I never did it for the Super Nintendo, oddly. And just like the Genesis Mega Drive, I had it, and I got rid of it, and I got it again. Well, the Super Nintendo, I did that too, one too many times, but since I stuck with it, I don't have as much as for that. But I still have a good amount, and the funny thing is, while I wanted to get more for the Genesis Mega Drive, and that was working for a time, not for a long time now, and then oddly it changed where I was finding the stuff for the Super Nintendo again, actually something for reasonable, and it wasn't just the common stuff, it was actually really good stuff too, and there's some of that here, but I think I'm gonna save some of that for the last, and I'll start with the more common, non-special stuff. So it was kind of weird how that was working. I was mainly only going for things I know I already really like a lot, or I want. And it was reasonable, which is kind of hard to do with that most of the time. But also only exclusive stuff, which most of this is exclusive. But some of them are just, it's something else that's also on the Genesis Mega Drive or whatever else. But I couldn't find it for that. And if I wanted it for that specifically, there's two like that. But, got to take what you can get. Although it's kind of perfect time to do this now because it's not going to change anytime soon because it's not like I can go looking for anything. This is not going to be any particular order, but I can remember what some of the last stuff I got was, so. Which I'm going to start off with one of those things. I'm just going to go through games, which this isn't exactly a game, but well, you know what it is. You use it for games. Anyway, so let's get this started because it's going to take long enough as it is. And so here we have the Super Game Boy. I wasn't going to get another one at first, but then the more I was thinking about it, I was, you know what, why not? There are a very small number of original Game Boy games I would like to get again and play, and there's a few that I never had for the actual thing before I would like to get. So, there's that, and then, well, I can't even do that now. But this was a pain in the ass to begin with, just trying to come by one, which usually never used to be, but then I did, and it didn't play any sound, so I had to take it back, and then waited for another one to show up, which is this one. Some idiot scraped off some of the contacts on here. Apparently they were the ones for sound, because everything else worked fine except for the sound, and I thought I was missing something obvious, I did something wrong, but no, it couldn't play sound. So fortunately, I got this one, which does work again. I'm not gonna go over the Game Boy games I got for it because it's not that many and that's not the point here. But it's nothing that special for any of them. Anyway, so let's get this going here. And this is one of the other more recent last ones I got. Super Off-Road again, I'm sure we all know this one. I like this game a lot, the original arcade game, and pretty much all the ports, although some are better than others. This is one of the ones I was referring to where I did want the Genesis Mega Drive one again. Just because this is what I wanted. I had it for the Super Nintendo before. It just fine. It's pretty much exactly the same. But this is what showed up. So hey, I can't complain. And of course, there's also that 3D one, which is kind of slow, but it's actually fairly decent itself. Actually, some write it off a little too harsh. I think Super Off-Road, the Baja. Might have got the subtitle wrong. Wouldn't mind getting that one again too. But this is the one I always liked the most. Which by this point, they got rid of the celebrity endorsement. Ivan Iron Man Stewart, and that's just called Super Off-Road at this point, which is the same game in the end. But this and the Genesis Mega Drive ports are easily the best, unless you count Midway Arcade Treasures, which is the arcade version on that disc. But hey, whatever. I'm talking about for kind of ports like this. Although I played the Game Boy one plenty, which there's no color, so it's fun trying to figure out what your truck is sometimes, and they all bunch up, and it's not the it's okay, but it's not the best version. This is one of the last games I got for it, and again, another one where I prefer the Genesis Mega Drive version, but in this case, it's very different. And this is one of the things I actually like about this. We all know about movie license games, but some are actually decent even back then. But with this one, I like most, they actually made pretty much every single version different, even between the Genesis Mega Drive and the Master System. Those are different. But here's the Super Nintendo one again. This is just what came up. In fact, I've seen the Genesis Mega Drive one plenty of times before all this, and I got this one. And I didn't get it for some reason. I don't know, I should have complete even and not for much. I will someday again whenever I can. Anyway, yes, so the Super Nintendo one, sure plenty of you are familiar with this. Again, I prefer the Genesis Mega Drive one for its style, but I like this one too. It has that kind of 3D kind of dungeon crawler aspect to it when you go into buildings, which is pretty fun. And then on the overworld or the outside, you're top-down isometric shooting stuff. In some ways, it's kind of better than the Genesis Mega Drive one. I mean, this one has more exploration going for it, and it's kind of non-linear, quote unquote. So in that way, it's more like the harder, much harder to come by Lost World game on the Genesis Mega Drive. But yeah, it was nice getting this one again. I did want this and the other one, but I just wanted the other one first. But that was more my fault, like I said. So yeah, there you go. All right, what we got here next? Oh yeah, this one. Of course, we're all familiar with the Chase HQ series, but this one here, not as many talk about it, and not as many are big on it. I recommend it personally. It's still plenty challenging, like the series always was, and it's a little shorter, I think, than some of them, but the last stage is brutal with the helicopter, but it's still pretty fun, and it's the, driver's seat view, like always. In some ways, I just kind of think it gets a few things better than the old one. I don't know, maybe it's just me. It's not hard to come by, and it's not expensive, so it's worth getting. And this is an exclusive for it, this particular entry in the series. So hey, if you want to get another exclusive that's not ridiculous price like a lot of them are, there you go, easy one right here. And which, by the way, most of these are going to be loose, but there's a few that I actually have in a box, and two of them are Japanese. Even though the one is only Japanese, so there's that. But the other one actually did come out in the West. Anyway, so let's go with this one next. And this is actually the first game I got for it when I got the Super Nintendo again, which anytime I did, which I did when too many times. I'm not going to go into that. I talked about that before in some other video, or brought it up a few times actually. But for some reason, every time I got a Super Nintendo again, F-Zero was always the first game I got again for it. I don't know why. I mean, I love racing, so there's that. It's one of the more easier and common games to find for it, so hey. And it's always a good time, of course. And while the first one isn't my top favorite, that's GX on the GameCube, still like this one a lot and play it plenty. And I've mentioned this before, but I still find it weird that it was single player only and it wasn't multiplayer. And I've never been able to find a specific answer for that, or if they even tried, but all I could think of is the Super Nintendo couldn't handle it, or it was too early for them to figure out, and it would be too slow, and it wouldn't, be all jerky and wouldn't work so well. Maybe that's why, I don't know. It's one of those kind of things I've always wondered about. Of course, post this, every single one was multiplayer. So hey, that's good. Okay, let's go with this one next. Another staple for the thing. And also one of the cases where the Super Nintendo actually did get the better version, because the Malibu, I've been on about this before plenty around, especially the other place where I spend most of my days. The Malibu developed version of Batman Returns for the Genesis Mega Drive is crap. So is the Master System version. The Sega CD one, which is completely different to those, which Malibu also did, is better, but it's still nowhere as good as this, which this is the only one for some reason Konami made. And of course, old Konami, they knew what they were doing. So hey, it's a difficult but a really good beat 'em up. And of course, I'm sure most of you know about the game by now. So hey, I like the movie a lot too. So that works for it. But then when it comes to the games based on the first one, the ones I prefer most is the Genesis Mega Drive and the very, very different and kind of odd PC Engine version, which didn't come out in the West for it, oddly. It's like Pac-Man in a way. All right, what are we gonna go with next? I don't want to show some of the really top-end ones, but we'll go with one right here because we all know it. Yeah, what do I need to say about this? Yeah, by now. Link to the Past, when I got into the series very, very late, this was the first one I played for. It was actually given to me at the time, 2008, so I finally got into the series, and even though I've gone through some others by now, I still consider this one of my favorite, but still think maybe Twilight Princess might beat it out. But anyway, I don't know, what is there to say about this? We all know it. It's in good shape, so hey, can't complain with that. All right, speaking of, here's another one, and yes, this is one of my top favorite games for the thing when it comes to this type of game anyway, and it's exclusive. The first Donkey Kong Country. Two, Diddy Kong's Quest is objectively improved and better, but I've always preferred the first one. It had nothing to do with nostalgia. There's genuine things about it and certain levels and all that make me like this more. Even the pain in the ass minecart one, we all know that annoying thing. Although I still think stop and go or whatever it's called, the one with the lights changing, that one's more annoying. Anyway, yeah, I always like the first one a lot. I still want the second one again. Three, it's good too. I just don't care about it. It's more of the same, which is not a problem, but at the same time, it's kind of what makes people not so big on it, is it really didn't. This one, and then you have the second one, which improves on it, and the third one doesn't really do all that much. It's more good but, stuff, it's more of the same, but it doesn't really push it even further, which I don't know. Well, then Donkey Kong Country Returns and Tropical Freeze do, but hey, I never got around to Tropical Freeze, but hey. Okay, let's go with this one next, because there is something specific I could talk about, even though we've seen this to death and so many show it over and over, but hey. Yeah, Super Mario All-Stars, and this is the version that has Super Mario World in it. Now, it might sound a little funny, but I have my reasons. I actually do prefer these separate. But I got it like this because, again, it was what was there at the time, it was reasonable, and I just dealt with it so I could get both and be done with it. But I do actually prefer both separately. Besides, it's just what I'm used to. There are actually points in this where Super Mario World will slow down where it doesn't when it's the standalone version. I swear I'm not making it up, I'm not imagining things, it happens, but it's a little annoying to me, and that's kind of one of the reasons I always like them separate. That it's just the way I am. I have had it like this before, and I've had it separate before too, so hey, whatever, and I just decided to live with it, so there you go. One of the best old compilations easily still. Although I still prefer the NES version of Super Mario Bros. 3, I still maintain that's the best one. I can't explain it, but I've said it plenty of times around, and many know what I mean. You can't exactly explain it. Sorry. Okay, so this next one, of course, is another common one, and we all know, and I still have to clean it up, even though I've had it for so long. I hate stickers and shit. Anyway, Top Gear. No relation to the BBC show, as I always have to say, because someone always thinks it does. It's just a coincidence. Anyway, the first one here, of course, was exclusive to the Super Nintendo, and it has that tragic thing, just like the one and only port that OutRunners has for the Genesis Mega Drive, where even when you're playing by yourself against the game itself, it's always got to be split screen. It's so dumb. I always thought there was like a code that you could do that in this to disable it, but sadly there isn't. Would have been nice. Same with the other one. But anyway, you get used to it and you still play it any. Really like it a lot. Always have. I do prefer 2, which that's another one where there are differences between this and the Genesis Mega Drive version, which once again I prefer the Genesis Mega Drive one. But the first one here, in some ways, is still better than that. That one's just kind of lasts longer. But fantastic music in this, and another easy and affordable exclusive you can get for the thing, which if somehow you don't have it already, go for it. If you're not that big on racing games, I don't know, if you just want to get as many exclusives for the thing as you can, why not start with ones like this and Super Chase HQ? Still cheaper than Donkey Kong Country 1. Okay, so what next to go with here? Okay, this one. I did a video on it long ago, and I think I got rid of it for some reason because I felt I could do it better, and I was going to redo it, and I never did, but whatever, I can go over it real quick here. This is one of those kind of misunderstood games, and part of that is because of the design, sadly. They could have done a better job with it. I've always liked it a lot, but then I actually put the effort to figure it out, and it's hard to explain like this, but I'm not even going to try right here. It's better if you could see it. But once you understand how this works, it's actually kind of smart, but at the same time, it's dumb. They overly complicated it, and it probably shouldn't have for the game it is. But when you do, it is pretty fun. It's one of the better old Godzilla games. That's just the honest truth. A lot of them in the past were, and before this were, the strategy game type. And some of those are actually good if you deal with the Japanese-only stuff and all that and you figure out how they work. But even then, for what kind of games they are, they're kind of poor, and you do better. Just pretty much anything by Koei, you can do better. Anyway, this one, though, for an action game like it is and a kind of a strange fighting game, when you get used to it and you figure it out, which don't read the manual because it's absolute nonsense. You have to figure it out on your own because shit translation. But Super Godzilla here is pretty fun when you get used to it. And sadly, it does take some getting used to. I hate saying that, but it's the truth. It has really good music in it, too. A very good rendition of the famous theme. So, you know, it's got that going for it, too. It's also one of the few Super Nintendo games that actually has a send test menu. So if you want to record your own soundtrack, there you go. Or you just want to play it like a jukebox. Okay, so what we got going on next here? Okay, here's another one that we all know and I can cover real quick. Super Mario Kart, another one I really wanted bad and I kept putting off for no real good reason, and I finally got it, and I kept seeing reminders of it and others showing it around, and they had it and I didn't again, and so there you go. Yeah, I don't know what else to say about that other than if you never heard of this before, it's kind of funny. This is one of the few games I know of in general for any system where it was actually PAL optimized and not NTSC or NTSC-J. So ironically, if you want the true best version, you kind of need the PAL version. It's very strange why they did that. And again, it's one of those things I wish I could find the answer because I'm just curious about that kind of stuff. But I've never found it, and I don't think anyone else has either. But it's one of those things that is known. But either way, it's still perfectly fine. North American here or Japanese, so you know it's not that much lower, but you know there's a little slight edge to the PAL version, which is ironic because that usually never happens. Usually they're shafted and they don't get any damn games. All right, so here's another heavy hitter. I don't have to talk about a lot because we all know. And oddly, I thought I would have to pay more for this at the time when I did, but hey, Super Castlevania 4. Some really like it a lot. I'm one of those. Some deride it because of whatever reasons. For me, I've always liked it a lot since back then, and it's also one of the ones in the series I actually play really well, unlike some others, which is weird. I mean, I prefer Bloodlines more, but that one's way trickier and harder, and I'm still not great at it. I mean, in general, I've always loved the Castlevania series. When it comes to hard series, Mega Man I'm useless at, and some others, Contra, whatever. But Castlevania was the go-to series for me, and still is for hard stuff, and that's why I like things like Bloodstaining, though it's not actually Castlevania, but it's close enough because, you know, Konami went to shit, so it's not like we're going to get an actual Castlevania again. And the last two they did were basically God of War wannabes. Anyway, Super Castlevania 4, I've always liked it a lot, and I had to have it again, so fortunately I got the chance, and for something actually far reasonable than I expected, which kind of blew my mind. Although at the time, some Castlevania games were kind of finally going down, like Symphony of the Night, the PlayStation version, not the Saturn one, sadly, which I really want the actual thing of. But hey, can't always get what you want, right? Alright, so let's get into some other stuff here. Go with this one next. Another one we all know, and I had to get this one again, much like Super Castlevania 4. It's another one from the past I really liked a lot, and this was my start with the series. And I still like it a lot, but I'm not as good at it as, well, even Super Castlevania 4, I admit. I get lost in this often, but that's part of the fun with exploring this. I don't know what else I can say about it. This is a really good game, and I know some get the Japanese one just because it's cheaper and you can get it all in English. I know that's there, but at the time, you know, I make dumb decisions sometimes, so I wanted to get the North American one, and so I did. And there you go. I could play Japanese games in my Super Nintendo fine because I had the pins broken off. And like I said, I have two Japanese games here to show, and those are the ones in boxes. One North American game is in box too, but that's a special one to me. Anyway, I just like that I was able to get this again, and it's just like the Saturn. I get Japanese games for it just because it's cheaper and it's the only option. Sometimes it all shows up, although that stopped some time ago. But if I can, I want to get the North American version just because that's what I'm used to. That's what I used to have for it, just like this. I could have done that with Super Castlevania 4, but I didn't. Anyway, all right, so this is a quick one. This is actually part of a series, but many people still don't know this. This is actually pretty good. I won't say it's amazing. It's the best pinball game you can get at the time for the Super Nintendo. Otherwise, there's some other ones on the Super Nintendo I'd put slightly higher on this. But if you can see, it's kind of title's kind of small. Oh, this is easier, actually. Super Pinball Behind the Mask. This is the second one in their series. Kaze, Craze, however you pronounce it. Anyway, this is another one that's very common and very cheap to get, at least here in North America. I definitely suggest it. It's only got three tables, but they're pretty good. The physics in this, it's good. It could be better, but it's definitely better than a lot of other ones I can think of. So it's a good fun time. I don't know what else to say for it. Definitely look into it, especially if you like pinball. And again, you want another exclusive for it, and it is not expensive or hard to come by. I mean, when you get in the box, that's another matter. I can't tell you about that. That's a little different story. Okay, so now let's get into some heavy hitters here. Sort of. And now we have Indiana Jones. Oop, as the lighting changes. Indiana Jones Greatest Adventures. I wasn't specifically going after this one. I mean, I like it, but it just kind of presented itself and was, again, another one that was way less than I expected it to be. So I just jumped on it. And there you go. Another exclusive and a good one. And some LucasArts action going on. Although, no, I don't have that mech game that goes for way too damn much. I wish I did. I do like it, but fortunately, emulation saves the day, as always. Alright, speaking of LucasArts, you probably know what's coming next. I wanted these again, and the way I got them was weird, but there you go, all three of the Super Star Wars games. Very difficult, but I've always liked them a lot, and, you know, you just play them. It's kind of like attrition, but it's fun, and they're not actually exclusive. Well, the first one is. Believe it or not, most people, I think, don't realize this, and they've only experienced the Super Nintendo one, but Super Return of the Jedi here was also for the Game Boy and Game Gear. I still need to try the Game Gear one out, because I'm more curious about that, because being my Sega stuff. But just like most, I've only really ever experienced the Super Nintendo version. Just to get this out of the way, if you're curious which of the three I like most, I actually kind of like Return of the Jedi most. I have my reasons. But anyway, so yeah, I wanted to get these again, and I just didn't see them coming up. Then one day, I saw these two rubber banded together for a stupid good price, in person, no less. Which is pretty much all this I got in person is the weirdest thing, because I wasn't finding jack all for anything, including Super Nintendo in person anymore, but hey. Got these two together for really good. So I was thinking, what if I could find the same day where I was Return of the Jedi? I was hoping for that because that would have been cool. But I didn't. So this one I had to use the internet for. And because I know what I'm doing, even though it takes longer than ever as time goes on to find someone who's not wacko on eBay. I did finally find this for something reasonable. So hey, I couldn't get it all in one go, which would have been amazing. At first, I saw there was only two of them, and I thought, what if Return of the Jedi was there, and I just didn't notice it, and I get all three in one bang, and it was so low. But I just have no luck like that. I have marginal luck randomly. But anyway, So, and I got Return of Jedi later. Pretty much that day I went looking for one and I ordered it. So, hey. And then I had all three again. Hooray! It kind of feels incomplete without those. Okay, so let's jump back to something that's kind of special, but not entirely. I'm going to do the two Japanese ones together. This one I actually have the manual, even though I don't have the box. It's just the way it came, and it kind of annoys me. It's nice, but at the same time, it annoys the shit out of me, because I don't know what to do with it. It's just hanging around loose, and I hate that. But anyway, I love... I'm a big X-Men fan, the old stuff, mostly. Like, from this time and all that. But I've gone on about before on here. I know I have X-Men 2 Clone Wars, the exclusive for the Genesis Mega Drive. Love that game. I prefer that more than this. But this is the Super Nintendo's equivalent to that, and it's an exclusive X-Men game. And it's also better than the first one in the Genesis Mega Drive, although that one's not bad. Some people think it is. It's not. It's kind of like the Super Godzilla game, only not to that same degree. It's just got a few quirks to it, and it takes some getting used to, but when you do, it's still fun. Navigation's a pain in the ass sometimes. Anyway, Mutant Apocalypse. Again, this is another exclusive for it, which is not as cheap as those other two I've mentioned already, like Super Off-Road and Super Chase HQ and Super Pinball Behind the Mask. There's too many Supers in the titles. At least this one doesn't. And yes, it came with one of the things. But this is another one that's far more reasonable than some others, and it's very good, and I definitely suggest getting Sohei. And, you know, if you're an X-Men fan, go for it, because we're not getting any new X-Men games still. Even though Disney runs it now, running to the ground. Okay, so here's another one of the more recent ones, and again, could go on about this one plenty, and saying things about the Genesis Mega Drive version, which, by the way, is not bad. I played both plenty. And the arcade version, mostly with MAME. But the Genesis Mega Drive is pretty much the same game. It's not as bad. I don't know why people ride the Super Nintendo one as much as they do. I only have it for this because, well, again, that's what showed up. The Genesis Mega Drive one is kind of harder to come by, so that is the way with some of these. So, whatever. That'll come up again with another game by Koei. Anyway, yes, we all know it. Sunset Riders. I've never been good at this. It's really hard, but I still like it, and I still want it again. And so I had a chance, and again, it wasn't as cheap as I wish it was, but it was lower enough, and it's definitely better than eBay, so I jumped on it because it's not a game, even the Super Nintendo version, that just shows up all the time, which some of these, that's the case. Now let's get into some more expensive ones to a degree. Well, this one is not that much more of a jump, and this is that one I was referring to in the Koei one. Okay, some of you might notice, many probably not, because it's not like anyone talks about it, because, you know, it's not like certain other ones that all anyone talks about. It's a very good game, though. It's actually an RPG, even though Koei's mostly known for their strategy games. But this has a kind of a strategy game vibe to it. I mean, of course, because they did it. You should be able to see the title there. Uncharted Waters New Horizons. This is actually the follow-up to Uncharted Waters, which I had experience with both. But again, this is one I specifically did want for the Genesis Mega Drive, you know, box and manual. That would have been nice. But the Super Nintendo version does show up more usually, although before all this, again, keep that in mind. At this point, when I say that, Super Nintendo stuff is all that was showing up for me, so you know, I decided to go for it. It was a long time since I played either emulation or otherwise, so it's still taking me a while to get used to this. But I consider it an unlucky game because the day after I got this, my glasses broke and they're the only ones I had, so I went for 3 weeks of not being able to see anything, so I couldn't really play any games either, which sucked, including this one. But now, fortunately, I have two pairs, so. If that ever happened again, I'm not going to be completely worthless and useless, and I can't do anything, which that was absolutely horrible. But yeah, it was nice getting this, even though it was, I want to get things in order usually, so it would have been nice to get Uncharted Waters first, but hey, I'll go for it. It's a very good game. Definitely suggest both of them if you've never played them. Again, the Genesis Mega Drive and the Super Nintendo version here, they're pretty much exactly the same, and I think the first one, or also maybe this one too, was on DOS. I can't remember off the top of my head. Anyway, so let's get into some actual heavy hitters here. I'm a big fan of the Cyberpunk stuff and the Shadowrun and all that kind of thing, so that's why top game I'm looking forward to is Cyberpunk 2077. But the old ones I like too, and I wanted to get them all except for that crappy, just uses its name, and that's about all it has in common with it, Xbox 360 game, which that was too online focused, so if I had it in an Xbox 360, I couldn't play it anyway. But I love the Genesis Mega Drive one, which is more kind of action-based, and I did get that one again. I'm sure I showed that in some old video. And then I had a choice that day between that and the Super Nintendo version, so you already know where I'm going with this. And fortunately, later on, I actually was able to get this, ironically, at the same place, but I doubt it was the same one I saw. This is very different. Some people prefer one, some people prefer the other. I already said I prefer the Genesis Mega Drive one, but I like both a lot, and so it was nice to finally get this. They both have very different ideas about what's going on, and also even their stories and how they all work, and all even just the way the game looks. In some ways, this one is superior to the Genesis Mega Drive one, although I just always like the feel of that one. Basically, if you want more action, you get that one. If you want more focus on story, you get with this one. But both have exploration, both have combat, and blah blah blah, and you can pretty much do what you want. Neither one are that strict in terms of what you have to do. Although this one is a little harder sometimes to figure out where you should go and what you should do. It expects certain things that the Genesis Mega Drive one doesn't as strictly. Anyway, so yeah, you got Shadowrun. I don't know what else to say about it. I was really happy to get this one again, so now I have both the Genesis Mega Drive and this one again. I also have Shadowrun Returns Hong Kong, and Shadowrun Returns Dragonfall, which that one came before Hong Kong. So hey, I'd probably get the Sega CD, Mega CD one. Actually, it's Mega CD, but it's Japanese only, because that's very different too. But I can't read, speak, or write Japanese, so it's pointless. All right, here's another heavy hitter, and ironically, I was able to get this one in person, which I never thought I'd get it ever again. Because people want way too much money for it on eBay. It's again another example of a game which is not actually rare, but people treat it like it is. It's a great game, of course, and everyone, including me, wanted a sequel to it, an actual sequel. You could say the Paper Mario series is, but it's not quite, of course. But that'll probably never happen, especially at this point. But hey, this one still exists, and it's still a great game, and old Square and Nintendo teaming up was the best thing you could hope for, so. Can't complain. Actually, to me, I consider the Mario and Luigi Superstar Saga the actual, like, kind of more closer follow-up to this. And some others do more than Paper Mario, which for me, I do more than Paper Mario. Especially the first one, but I don't know. Which I do have that for the Advance again, since I got the Micro. But this was a lot more than I would have been willing to, but it's a special game, and I knew I wasn't going to get the chance again. And it's really good shape, and I didn't have to deal with eBay, so you know, I did it. Fortunately, I had enough on me. That's the case with a lot of this. Oh, I want that. I don't have enough on me. All right, let's go over the two Japanese games, which are in boxes, and then we'll go one more that's in the box that's North American, and I think some of you might know what it is, especially you know if you're watching this and you talk to me the other place, and this is going on longer than I want it to, but hey, that's how it goes. I'm trying to speed this up because there's something else I want to do. Time. All right, so this is one I've actually had before. And let's not go into that and see what decisions I make. But this is another exclusive. It's not that hard to come by. Again, it's Japanese only, and it's not all that expensive, even in the box here. I'm not going to take it out. You know what a manual looks like in a Japanese Super Famicom cartridge. Anyway, some aren't so big on this. I've played more racing games than anything else, so I'm more qualified than some. It's a good game. It's not the most amazing one. This is definitely not on the level of Neo Drift Out, which costs a frick ton. I wish I had that for my NVS, but this is part of the same series, and that's kind of why I mentioned it, and you can tell by the title. This is Super Famicom exclusive, and like I said, Japan only, but if you like racing and you don't mind the isometric top-down, I mean literally top-down, it's not even like the side view like Neo Drift Out is, you could do worse than this. There are some crap rally games out there, and there's some really good ones, and two I know of were arcade only, sadly, but that's for another time, although I did do a video on the one. This is definitely one worth looking to again if you want to get exclusive for it that you don't have to sell your kidneys for. This is another one to consider. Alright, speaking of racing. Alright, so this one actually did come out in North America. This is the one I kept referring to throughout this. In Japan, it's called Human Grand Prix because the name of the developer is Human, as you can see down here. In North America and Europe, I think only North America got it. I can't remember the name right now. I think it's F1 Race or no, that's the Game Boy game. It's something like F1, whatever. A lot of the games at the time had that type of title, even the Japanese only ones on the Sega CD and all that. This is a pretty good one, but it does something weird. It tries to simulate analog steering with a D-pad. It actually works, but you do kind of need to rein yourself in and adjust to it. And when you do, it's actually really nice. It's kind of cool they tried doing that. You can see some screenshots here. I doubt I'll do a video on this. It's hard to make racing games interesting than most people. Me, I just play this stuff for hours on end. But it's a good one. And again, it's not Japanese only, but this one is. I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure I'm not. Thinking back from memory, this is another one which is Super Nintendo slash Super Famicom exclusive. So it's not all that much, even like this in a box in Japanese, so, you know, one to consider if you want to get exclusives for it. And it is just a good racing game for it in general. There are some bad Formula One-based racing games for this and the Genesis Mega Drive, but this is a good one. It's not amazing, but it's good. And so with that is all the games. Hopefully I didn't drone on too long or anything like that, and I didn't mess up anything. But accidents happen. So that's it. Thanks for watching, and I will see you whenever I do another video.